So tonight, we're going to be talking about healing. How many believe that it's God's will and he wants you to be healed? Amen? I think it's interesting how many times that in talking with people, especially, newer people in our church or people that have just started to get into this, how many people just say things like, well, whatever God wants to do, if God wants to heal some, he might not want to. And I want to really, first of all, encourage you and challenge you tonight. God wants to heal everybody. And there should never be a doubt whether or not he wants to heal everyone. He wants to heal everyone. But the specific thing is he wants to heal you. Come on, you got to help me out tonight. Don't be quiet on me. God wants to heal you now. Like not next year, not next month, now. So let me explain to you the difference than something I think that will help you tonight. God's word is not settled in every area. So let me explain it like this. God doesn't have anything in his word about who you should marry. There's nothing in there. He does say whoever finds a wife finds a good thing, but there's no scripture that says you marry this person, right? So there's nothing on that to stand on because it's not in the Bible. But there are certain things in the Bible that are finished. I'll say this way. It's already done. It's already completed. And all you have to do is receive it in your life. So if you're living your life as whatever God wants to do, sometimes he heals, sometimes he doesn't. I'm not sure if he wants to heal me or not. I tried one time and it didn't work. Listen, this isn't that kind of a thing. This is, I don't try this, I'm to live this. So instead of trying to get healed, you have to start seeing yourself healed. I am healed because of what Jesus did. Not because of how I feel. There are times I don't feel healed. How many here have ever felt like you don't feel like you're healed right now? Right? If we went by our feelings, most of us wouldn't ever come to church because we don't even feel like we're saved. But we don't go by feelings. We walk by faith and not by sight. Amen? So I want to encourage you tonight. We're gonna continue on in this series on healing. So there are 19 individual cases of healing that we have recorded, individuals that came to Jesus and needed healing. Now, there are multitudes in the Bible that were healed by Jesus. Scripture says multitudes were healed. We don't know who they are. We don't know what they had. We just know multitudes were healed. But we're not talking about them. We're talking about individual cases that we have record of. They came to Jesus, they needed healed, and they got healed. Here's what we said. Out of those, I really think there's more than 19, and I've talked to you before about why I think that, because there was a guy that one of Jesus's disciples cut his ear off, right? And we've talked about it before. Jesus picked the ear up, put it back on, and it was a miracle. The man was completely healed in front of a bunch of people that were there to kill Jesus, to take him as a prisoner, hated Jesus. And one of the men who had his ear cut off hated Jesus. And Jesus put his ear back on, which tells me Jesus will heal anyone if he will heal his enemy. This man was there to take Jesus in. This man did not love him. This man was not a follower of his. And Jesus picked up that ear, put it back on. If Jesus will heal an enemy, Jesus will heal you being his child, right? I mean, I think there's so much right there that you could walk out and say, ah, that helps me a lot. If he'll heal his enemy, then he'll heal me. I'm not his enemy. You're not his enemy. So we said out of those 19 cases, almost about close to 3/4 of them, Jesus turned to them and said, your faith made you whole. So interesting enough, Jesus didn't say this. I'm the Son of God. I have all kind of power. I can heal anyone I want, anytime I want. If I want to do it, I can do it. He didn't say that. He turned to them and said, your faith made you whole. So what's interesting about that is their faith brought healing out of Jesus. Your faith today could bring the same thing because faith has not been done away with. So we talked about all these things, just throwing some things out there for you to remember. So the last time that we taught, which would have been the week before last week when Pastor Bill preached, we talked about the blind man that was healed and he had to throw aside a coat that he wore that showed that he was blind. Not only did it show that he was blind, he used that coat to collect money when he was begging from people that were walking by. So he had to throw that off, got to Jesus, and Jesus healed the man of being blind. Now listen, if we looked it up, back then we had the doctors we have today, they would have said, there's a name for this. This man is blind because this happened in his life. Names do not intimidate God. And names do not intimidate Jesus. He's not impressed with the name of what they told you is going on with yourself or your friend or your husband, wife, son, daughter. He's not up in heaven saying, oh my gosh, I never thought that would happen to anyone. Names do not intimidate him. According to scripture, names have to bow to his name. So whatever name you got going on tonight, whether it's blindness or whether it's deafness or whether it's heart disease or whether it's cancer or whatever it might be, according to scripture, it has to bow to the name of Jesus. So tonight I want to look at another blind man in scripture. So if you have a Bible there, you can turn with me to Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8, and we're going to start reading in verse 22. Mark chapter 8, verse 22. And here's another story of another man who's blind, who's healed. Listen to what it says, verse 22. Then he came to Bethesda, and they brought a blind man to him and begged him to touch him. I want everyone to look up. If you're still in the mentality that if you beg God long enough, he'll do something for you, God never moves in New Covenant, and what the New Covenant says, he doesn't move when we beg anything from him. These people were under the Old Testament. Jesus was literally walking on the earth. Since then, we have a Bible. And since then, we have a New Testament, a New Covenant, and it tells us how to live. It says we walk by faith and not by sight. So you can't beg from God and think you're going to receive anything. God doesn't want you to be a beggar. Listen, if you're a person of faith, you can't be a beggar and a person of faith at the same time. I'll say that again because it's going over really well. I love some of your faces right now. Listen, you cannot be a beggar and a person of faith at the same time. If you're going to walk by faith, you don't beg ever from God. God doesn't look down from heaven and saying, they're doing a great job begging. I'm going to answer their prayer. Come on, smile. God doesn't work like that. God lives and works in a faith realm, and he wants you to be a faith person, and begging doesn't fit faith. You can't be a beggar and then say, I'm a person of faith. If you're a person of faith and you believe what the scripture says, you go to God and ask him, trusting he's going to do what he said he's going to do. You don't beg him because he doesn't move by begging. He moves by faith. Are you with me? So they came and they begged, and that I wanted to just hit it real quickly because you might look at it and say, that's what I'm missing. I'm not begging. God doesn't want you to be a beggar. Next verse, verse 23. So he took the blind man by the hand, Jesus did, and he led him out of the town. And when he had spit on his eyes, everyone say spit. Now guys, listen, this isn't the first time Jesus spits. In fact, we have two other times in scriptures, in the gospels, where he spits on someone. Now, three times out of these cases we have, he spit on people, but then multitudes were healed, and we never have a place where it says he spit on the multitude. But I want you to know this, if spitting was the answer, then we could just spit on people and we'd all be good. Everyone would be healed, right? Spitting's not the answer. It's what God obviously told Jesus to do in those cases. If we'll listen to what he says to do in our own lives and even in helping others, then we're going to have the best results. So think about it. Jesus takes the guy, leads him out of the town. We'll talk about it in a moment. And he spits on him. Now, in one of the cases, a man had a tongue, the scripture says, that was tied, and the scripture says he spit on the man's tongue. I don't like that thought. But that's what he did. Now, here's the thing about it. If you cannot speak, and Jesus came and spit on you, and you were healed, you'd be saying, man, go for it. You spit on me as much as you want, if it meant you were going to be healed, right? So check it out. Because under the law, I don't know if you know this or not, if someone spit on you under the law, you were taken out of the camp according to what they said in the Old Testament for 7 days, and you were called unclean just because someone spit on you. It was considered something very unclean. Here's what I think is interesting. Jesus, of course, came to fulfill the law. Right? He came to fulfill the law. He is the fulfillment of the law. So you know what Jesus did? Jesus decided, I'm going to take something unclean, I'm going to do it, and I'm going to make it clean. I'm going to take something that is considered unclean, spitting, and I'm going to heal a person right in front of everyone. In other words, the people that were religious of that day, the people that lived under the law, they had to be looking at this with total disgust. You are going to spit on someone and heal them by doing that? To them, that wasn't a miracle. To them, that was disgust. But Jesus took something that was unclean and made it clean. Are y'all with me? So check it out. Watch what it says. It goes on and says, he put his hands on him and he asked him if he saw anything. And he looked up and said, I see men like trees walking. Interesting. Verse 25. Then he put his hands on his eyes again and made him look up, and he was restored and saw everyone clearly. Then he sent him away to his house, saying, neither go into the town nor tell anyone in the town. We'll get back to some of those thoughts in a moment. But here's what I want to look at first. You know how the idea is, if Jesus is the one laying hands on you, you'd be healed instantly and there wouldn't be a problem. Here's what's interesting. Jesus lays his hands on this man, spits on him, and asks the man to open his eyes and said, can you see? And the man said, well, I can see men, women, whoever, looking like trees. In other words, he couldn't see clearly. What's interesting about it is this, he could see. Up to this point, he couldn't see. And so don't miss this point. Listen closely. Jesus touched this man and spit on him, and he could see. If you went from not being able to see to seeing people look like trees, you are seeing. Interesting enough, we think that the moment Jesus would do something, it'd be done. And it'd be perfect, right? I've heard people say before, if Jesus heals you, then it's perfect every single time. Well, this wasn't perfect. Jesus spit on him, something I believe God told him to do. Jesus put his hand on him, something I believe God told him to do. And the man doesn't see clearly. He's got to do it a second time. Which couple things you need to hear. That gives us hope that sometimes if we don't see something instantly or it doesn't happen that first time or whatever, don't quit. Don't give up. Jesus went ahead and did it again. And what happened? The man could see completely clear. Man could see completely clear. Now, I want you to notice something. I want you to, back in verse 23, watch what this says. It says, Jesus led him out of the town, right? And then if you skip down to verse 26, it says, I don't want you to go back to that town, nor tell anyone in that town. I would say there's a problem with the town. Right? You took the guy out of the town, you told the guy, don't go back into the town, and you told the guy, don't tell anyone in the town what even happened. That would be a town problem, right? I think it's interesting because this place, Bethesda, is talked about somewhere else in the scripture. Jesus talked about it. So holding your place where you're at, if you have a Bible, I'm going to read Matthew chapter 11 real quickly. Watch what this says. It'll be on the screen starting in verse 20. It says this, then he began to rebuke the cities in which most of his mighty works or miracles had been done because they did not repent or they did not put faith in him. Watch what it says. Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you who? That's the town that he just took the man out of. Woe to you, Bethesda, for if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I say to you, it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the day of judgment than for you. Here's what Jesus is saying. These people wouldn't put faith in me, and they saw my miracles. And you know how sometimes people say this? If someone saw a miracle, man, you see a miracle at church, everybody's going to believe. No, they're not. These cities saw miracles. He said, you saw the mighty works that I did, and you still didn't turn to me. That means this, they didn't believe. So listen closely. Jesus takes this man from Bethesda, one of these cities that he's talking about. He takes him by the hand and he takes him out of the city. You say, well, one more miracle might have done it. No, he said, you saw all the stuff that I did and you still didn't believe in me. See, this sort of goes contrary to what a lot of Christians believe a lot of times, right? Man, you just get someone get up out of a wheelchair in a service. Everybody believe. No, they won't. It doesn't mean God doesn't want to do that, by the way, but it is not seeing that will make someone believe. Because you could have all kind of miracles go on, obviously. No one's going to be better than Jesus was. And Jesus said, all this stuff went on, and you still did not believe. So I want to just bring out a couple of points, just real quickly, about this story in Mark's gospel where we read about this man and Jesus taking him out of the town. Jesus telling him, don't go back into the town. Here's what's interesting about it. It's not the first time Jesus took someone out of a town. So this was a practice of his. He took people out of a situation. So here's what's interesting. I think it's really interesting. Jesus one day is walking down the road and someone says, please come and heal my daughter. And by the time Jesus is on his way, the lady with the issue of blood stops Jesus, you know, and then they come to him and say, your daughter's dead. Don't bother the master any longer. And what did Jesus say to the man? He said, peace out. You stay without getting an unbelief, and I guarantee you your daughter's going to have something good happen. So he just said, okay, and he kept on following Jesus. When Jesus got to the house, he did what? He kicked people out of the room when he got to the house. So this is sort of his practice, taking people out of environments that aren't conducive to get anything happening. So if you're taking notes, I want you to write some stuff down. I'm going to just go over a few points, and then we're going to let you go. The reason why I believe Jesus took this man out of the town, number one, is because of the unbelief that was in the town. Jesus took the man out of the town because of the unbelief that was in the town, and he wasn't going to do anything there, so he just took the man out. Now listen closely. There are going to be times you need to get out of the environment that is causing you to stay stuck right where you're at. There are going to be times you have to just get it. You got to get out of that environment. That environment is not healthy for you. That environment is causing you not to get what you need to be getting from God. That environment is holding you back from where God wants to take you. That environment is not conducive to miracles. That environment is not going to cause you to have healing come into your life. You need to get out of the environment. Let me just say this to you, because I know in some things I'm definitely old school. There are other things that I do my best not to be old school and want God to do whatever he's doing right now, but there are some things that I'm old school about. Here's one of them, just real quickly. What you're listening to at your house all the time can cause you to have an environment that is not conducive for God's best in your life. Some of you are like, I'm not gonna clap to that one. And here's why I say it's old school, because I grew up with this being told to me all the time. You know, back when we were growing up, of course, cassette tapes, if you remember those, if you Google them, you'll find out what they were. But just, so I grew up back in the day, reel to reel. Y'all remember reel to reel? Like, you have to be older to remember this. But reel to reel is how we listen to music. Then we graduated from reel to reel to 8-tracks. Anyone remember an 8-track? Just Google them and you'll find out what they are. And then when they came out with cassettes, it was like, oh my gosh, nothing could get better than this. It's a cassette. It went from these gigantic things, from an 8-track to a little cassette. It was so awesome. And we were told back in that day, you should have either music in your house playing all the time that is conducive to God doing something in your life and in your house, right? Singing songs like this last song we just sang, I'm no longer a slave, right? Those kind of things. Why? It's creating an atmosphere. So, you know, I grew up in a different era than maybe some of you did as far as Christianity goes and Christ following, all of that. But here's what I know. There's a difference in my life and there's a difference in my home if I have that playing versus whatever, something that's full of unbelief, something that's full of just bad stuff. It's going to affect me. You're like, well, I don't know if that's in the Bible. I don't know if that's really scriptural. I don't know if I like what you're saying. So here's what's interesting about it. In Peter, I believe it's in 2 Peter, Peter's writing about a guy in the Old Testament by the name of Lot. If you remember the story of Lot, remember that whole story? If he turned, you know, when they were walking out of the city, they would turn to a pillar of salt. And remember, his wife did. She just went to a pillar of salt. People are like, well, why'd God do that? God told him, God warned him, just don't look back and it won't happen. Why not? Why? I just want to take a peek real quick. Because that's the way we are, right? She turned into a pillar of salt. But anyway, this is what it says about Lot. In the New Testament, this is New Testament, it says that righteous man Lot, even though he didn't live a righteous life, God called him righteous. He said that righteous man Lot, he was worn down by what he saw and by what he heard. What you see and what you hear is wearing you down or building you up. It's the only two things that it can do. I'll say it again. Listen closely. This is about Lot. It's in 2 Peter. It says this, that righteous man was worn down by what he saw and by what he heard. Eventually in your life, you're going to realize this. You're going to finally wake up to it someday. What I see and what I hear is either wearing me down, wearing me out, draining me, or it's building me up, one or the other. So here's the thing about it. That righteous man Lot, what he saw, what he heard, he's the only one that was responsible for that. Someone else wasn't responsible. He was responsible. What you see and what you hear create an atmosphere. Jesus took this man out of the town because the atmosphere in the town wasn't conducive to what Jesus wanted it to be. And he's like, I'm not going to do anything here. Come on with me. Now, can you imagine if, you know, I remember stories like this. They sort of blow me away. Brother Hagin, who was my spiritual father, he made this statement one time. He said, I was in a church full of so much unbelief. During the service, I knew if I did this, the pastor couldn't say anything about it. He said, how many of you in the service tonight would be willing if I followed the same thing Jesus did in the Bible? And everyone was like, yes, yes. Even the pastor's like, yes, yes. Do whatever you feel. And he said, the environment was so full of unbelief. He said, I'm gonna do something. He didn't tell these people this. He said, let's read this scripture. Jesus took him by the hand out of the town. He said, if you need healing tonight, I wanna take all of you to another room. And he took him out of the service because the church was so full of unbelief. He took him out of the service and ministered healing to him in another room. We're responsible. Even though we're here tonight and most of us tonight probably are Christ followers in this place, we're responsible to be believers, not doubters. And what gets my believing and my doubting going this way or that way is what I see and what I hear. I don't want to hear someone telling me that God doesn't heal because it's not in the scripture. So I want to hear someone that's going to tell me God still heals today. God will heal you. God will heal your mind. God will heal your body. God will heal whatever situation you're going through. You want to hear that, not a bunch of unbelief. So second thing, if you're taking notes, when it comes to healing, you can only go as far as people will go with you. Say what? Yeah, when it comes to healing, you can only go as far as people will go with you. So tonight, if I said, I believe God wants you free from addiction, and you were there standing and you said, I don't believe he wants to set me free, God can't go any further than that. You stop how far God will go by what you say or what you believe. I don't believe God can do that for me. He won't. That's the thing about God. He will never overpower what you say. I don't believe that can happen in my life. I don't believe that can happen in my family. I don't believe God can heal my son or my daughter. I don't believe that God can do this or God can do that. No, no, no. He only can go as far as people will let him. That's why environments become so important. What kind of environment do you have in your car? What kind of environment do you have in your home? What kind of environment do you have with your family? It's a good thing to think about, right? Number three, and I want you to write this down because we've been talking about environments. So These last two will help you out. You cannot go back into an environment of doubt and unbelief and expect to be healed. Let me give you an example real quick, and I'll go over this last one and we'll be done. Listen to this. A friend of mine taught at Rhema Bible Training Center. He taught healing school for years. And he said he noticed this. He noticed people would come into healing school, and when you would look out, it looked like death, and death was in the air. Because most people that came to healing school, this was their story. They gave up on me, and they said, I'm going to die. So they would go to healing school as a last resort in Tulsa. So they are, they're in healing school. They're like, we're here, last resort. Some of them couldn't breathe. You could hear them breathing on machines. I mean, just crazy stuff. People would come in there from all over the world. There were times there were prince, like a person who was a prince from another country, who would fly a relative in just so they could sit in healing school and hear the word about healing. And he told me this. He said, I would preach on healing, and by the end of the week, it was like a whole different atmosphere. The environment completely changed. He said, but most of them would go home for the weekend. And he said, we're talking about people that had to be on a breathing machine, that by the end of the week, they were off the breathing machine. He said, but then they would go home. And this is what's asked when you go home around people that don't believe the same way you do, right? This is what's asked. Are you okay? You don't look okay. You look bad. Is something wrong with your skin color? You look like you're dying. And he said they'd come back the next week after that. The weekend would go by. They would come back on Monday. And he said they lost everything that they had because they went from an environment of faith into an environment of unbelief. And if you think environments aren't important, you need to make sure you start watching environments that you're in and watch what happens to you. Right? You can be in an environment, and in the environment you're in, all the people that are there look down at you. All the people there treat you bad. And you know it as well as I do. You start to shrivel up. You're like, it changes who you are because the environment is looking like that. Well, when you get in an environment of unbelief, opposite of what God wants for your life, which is you being in faith and believing that he's going to do something, even though it looks crazy right now, that he can do it because he said nothing is impossible to those who believe, right? So if you get into an environment like that, how about if we start doing this? What if we start changing the environments that we're in instead of letting them change us? What if the environment you're in is just a negative? Anyone here ever be like around a negative environment? It's not fun to be around, right? It's like, oh, after you've been in this for so long and doing it like I have and others in our church, after a while, you just don't even go near environments like that. It's like, if you wonder why I disappear sometimes out of certain environments, it'd be this. I don't want to be in an environment that all you're going to do is talk negative all the time. Why? Because that produces something, right? So we're not trying to be mean to people. You don't go up to people and tell them, you know what, you set the wrong environment, so I'm out of here. You don't have to tell anyone anything, right? If you're at someone's home and you're eating or whatever and the environment's really bad, all you have to do is, oh my gosh, I got to go. Right? You don't have to tell them why. I got to get going. You get in your car, you're like, Lord Jesus, thank you for delivering me from that environment. You can't say that I want healing in my life, whether it's mental, whether it's physical, and then say I'm going to keep on going back into an environment that produces nothing but doubt and unbelief. You got to be around an environment that produces life. So let me just tell you this. I'll do number four and we'll be done. Now listen, I've been doing this for a long time, right? I've been pastoring this church. I believe this year's going into our 29th year. So it's been a long time here. Four or five years with my brother Joe for 5 years as an associate and youth pastor in his ministry. And then here for this many. So 30 some years I've been doing this. And you know what I do still every single day? Now, you know, if you're a younger person, you know this. People love podcasts, right? If you talk to some people, they're like, I listen to this many podcasts, you know? So last year, I think it was a minimum, I listened to almost 700 podcasts. 700. Over 90% of them were on healing. Just listen to it over and over and over. You say, well, that's just a waste. Over and over. Why? I'm going to set an environment. And if you understand this, listen, there's all kind of podcasts out there. You want to listen to TED Talks all day? You can listen to them all day. I want to listen to talks that have something that actually will actually help my faith out, especially in my life of areas that I want to build up and make stronger by what he saw and by what he heard. Lot was affected. He was worn down. Or by what he saw, what he heard, you can be built up. You can change what you're seeing. You can change what you're hearing. Here's number four. Number four. Environments are charged with either faith or doubt all the time. And I know these two, this is what we've been talking about, but just listen to this. Environments all the time. You're setting an environment right now while you're listening to me. So what do you mean? Like if you're here right now and you're thinking, I don't know if I agree with everything, you just set an environment. You got to prove that to me. Show me some more stuff. You set an environment. Here's something that I always heard while I was growing up. Be quick to believe, slow to doubt. In fact, it's better not to doubt anything from Scripture, right? But be quick to believe. Why? I'm going to believe what Jesus said over what some man has said for years that he thinks that Scripture does say. I have a lot of commentary, so I was reading commentaries on this about Jesus taking him out of the town and about why Jesus did that and why Jesus had to heal him outside the town. And the best that most commentaries could come up with was this. He didn't want to start a frenzy in that town of healing, so he took him out. That was the best they could do. I was like, really? No, if you read Scripture and you read about Bethesda like we just did, he didn't do it there because he was tired of doing miracles in their town and them not believing. Setting an environment. Jesus walks into a town, does a miracle, and sets an environment of, look, the Son of God is here. I'm doing miracles. And here's what they thought. We don't believe it. You have to do more than that. You want me to believe. What did they want? What did you have to see for one day Jesus goes in John's gospel and his friend dies and he calls him out of a grave. For all of you that have never heard me teach on it before, he has 200 pounds of cloth on that they would wrap you. They say it weighed about 240 pounds of cloth. They wrapped him in. He didn't walk out. He's wrapped. He floated out. He had to. You didn't walk in. It wasn't like you're coming out. Hold on a second, Jesus, I'm coming. I mean, thanks for rolling the stone away and I'm going to come out. No. The Scripture says he came right out. And here's what Scripture says. The day that Jesus said, Lazarus, come out, that others came out of their graves. When you want to be alive in that day and say, well, I'll believe now. There's Uncle Tom over there. Just came out of a grave, right? You're going to believe now? No, these two towns that he talks about, these two towns didn't believe no matter what he did. So you either can be a person who believes and sets that environment up. I'm a person who believes. I'm going to believe what God said in his word no matter what. Or you can be a person that no matter what God does, you don't believe it anyway. God healed my cousin. God healed my brother. Well, I don't believe it. There was a guy in the Scripture named Thomas. He said, I don't believe anything unless I'm going to see it. And we as Christians have to watch out that we are not setting an environment that I have to see something before I believe. Faith is all about, even if I don't see it naturally, I believe what God says in his word because I'm going to believe what he said over what I see. Amen? So tonight, let's close our eyes just for a moment. If you need healing tonight, we talked earlier about addiction, but that's just one type of thing. If you need healing tonight, I believe God wants to heal you in this place tonight. So I'm going to ask you to do me a favor. His eyes are closed just for a moment. If you need healing, I want you to stand up right where you're at. Just stand up on your feet for a moment, if you can. If you can't stand, you can raise your hand. If you can't raise your hand, you can just be in faith wherever you're at. Just stand up if you can. Raise your hand if you need it and you can't stand. Or if you're here and you're like, man, I can't do either of those things, just get into faith right now. Just believe. I believe I can hear what the word of God's being talked about right now, so I'm going to receive just by faith tonight. Now, if you need healing in your body, I want you to put your hand wherever it is you need healing on your body right now. Just put your hand wherever you need a touch from God. Put it on your body right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for for every individual in this place tonight. We've heard your word. We have an environment here tonight of healing. We have an environment here tonight of faith. We believe that you said nothing is impossible to him who believes. So tonight, Father, we release healing power into each person's body. And we thank you right now, Father, that their body, miracle powers released into them and they begin to recover in the name of Jesus. We believe that right now, their bodies are strong, their bodies are whole. In Jesus' name, we declare. If you agree with it, everyone shout amen. Now let's lift our hands, everybody in the house, just lift your hands for a moment and let's say this out loud. I believe I'm healed. In Jesus' name, amen. Now let's shout. Come on, let's just give God some praise. Father, we magnify. We thank you that we're healed. We thank you that we're whole. In Jesus' name. You can be seated.